So good morning, and so yesterday we have seen, we have studied different kind of resolution, that is special resolution, then grayscale resolution, temporal resolution, and spectral resolution. And also we have seen the difference between the low level image processing and mid level image processing, high level image processing. Okay. Now in today's lecture, we'll study, okay, what is meant by bit plane slicing, okay, what is the use of that one, and then what are different application of image processing. Okay, so we'll try to finish application part of image processing in today's lecture. Okay, now this bit plane means, so for example, if you have a grayscale image on the top left corner, okay, so in grayscale image, how many bits are there in which is representing 1 pixel? 8 bits. Okay, so if you separate out, okay, each plane of that bit, you see that in 8 bit representation of the image, you have LSB plane, you have then first bit plane, and then MSB will be your 8th bit plane. Okay, so overall 1 pixel will be represented with 8 bits. Okay, so here in bit plane concept, what we are doing, we are separating, okay, first bit of all the pixels, okay, LSB bit of the all the pixels. So we will get one plane. Okay, now this one plane, what will be the size of this one? See, you have a image, grayscale image, which is represented as 8 bit. Okay, now you are separating each plane of that pixel or of that image. Okay, so consider the first bit plane. Okay, so if you have separated out this one, now what will be the physical size of this bit plane? It will be the same. That is, suppose for example, if your original image is of 256 by 256, what will be the size of this one? 256 by 256. Now each pixel will be represented by how many bits here? 1 bit, because you have separated out that one, okay, the last bit plane you have separated out. So each pixel is represented by 1 bit. Okay, so it will be what kind of image then? A binary image. Okay, because that bit plane will be having value either 0 or 1. Okay, if it is 0, it will be black. If it is 1, it will be white. Okay, now if you display that bit plane, okay, it will have a binary image. In the same fashion, okay, if you take it out the second bit plane, okay, again it will be another binary image, third bit plane or even seventh bit plane. So right from 0 to 7 bit plane you are separating out. Okay, now why we are studying this one, would like to see where information is more, in which bit plane information is more. Okay, see that this is the 0th bit plane here and this is 7th bit plane. Okay, so what we are doing, we are separating this bit plane and then we are representing this, okay, with this image. If you consider the entire all these bit planes, the overall image will be grayscale image, okay, which is represented in, okay, this top left corner. Now from this image we are separating the bit planes. So suppose for example this is the 7th bit plane separated out from this one, and now we are displaying this 7th bit plane here. What kind of image we are getting here? A binary image, because that bit plane will consist of only either 0 or 1 value. Similarly, take 6th bit plane out and you'll get the image which is displayed like this. Okay, now 5th bit plane is, okay, overlapping here, actually I have shifted here, and then this is 4th bit plane. Okay, now just observe, okay, the information contained in all those bit plane, that is 7th bit plane, 6th bit plane, 5th bit plane and 4th bit plane. Now we are going further, that is, see that here, This is bit plane number 3. This is bit plane number 2. And this is bit plane number 1. And this is bit plane number 0. So, we have started from 0. So, in total, how many bits are there? 7, 8. Okay. So, there are 8 bit planes in total. If we start from 1, it will be 8. We have started from 0. So, it will be 7. Okay. Now, you have observed all those bit planes separately. Okay. So, what is your observation from all those figures or all those images? Basically, the information in the MSB bit plane is higher as compared to lower bit plane. Okay. So, generally, even if you discard the lower bit plane, you are not going to lose much information. Okay. And that is what the concept which is used in compression, image compression, okay, that is bit plane slicing. Okay, bit plane BTC, that is bit plane truncation. Okay. So even if you truncate the lower bits, okay, you are not going to lose the much information. Okay. So as for example, in yesterday's lecture, we have seen the grayscale resolution. Okay. What we did there, we kept all the spatial resolution same, that is number of pixels were same. Only thing is that what we changed? We changed the number of bits to represent each pixel. Okay. Initially it was 8 bit. We observed the image. After that, 4 bits, we observed the image. Okay. So we did not recognize much difference between the 8 bit representation and the 4 bit representation. But when we reduce further with only 2 bit representation, it was okay, recognizable. So here basically most of the information of image lies in the MSB side. So you can discard the lower bits. Suppose for example, if you have discarded lower 2 bits. Okay. Now in earlier case, okay, in earlier case, suppose for example, if your image is of size 256 by 256 and each pixel is represented by, okay, 1 byte or 8 bit. Okay. So, memory required to store that image will be 256 into 256 bytes. And now, suppose for example, if you have discarded the LSB, 2 bit planes, that is last bit plane and the, okay, second last one. Okay. So, how many bits you are using for representing each pixel? 6. Okay, so memory required to store that one will be 256 into 256 into 6 bits. So that much memory will be needed. So definitely it will be less than that of the earlier one. So you can save the memory for storing the image. Now, okay, already we have seen the dimensionality of the image, okay, or dimensionality of the signal, that is 1D signal, 2D signal or 3D signal. Okay. So, basically, what is the difference between the 1D, 2D and 3D signal? Number of independent variables. Okay. In case of 1D signal, number of independent variable is 1. In 2D signal, number of independent variables are 2, that is X and Y coordinate. Okay. And dependent variable in that case is intensity. Okay. Whereas, in case of your video signal, okay, you have how many variables basically? There are 4 variables. One is X coordinate, another one is Y coordinate, and third one is time. Okay. And then dependent variable is intensity. So there are 3 independent variables. So that is called as 3-dimensional signal. Okay. Video is called as 3-dimensional signal. Okay. Now we'll skip this part. Okay. Now we'll see the applications of image processing. Okay. So there are 2 types of, okay, first one we'll see image compression. Okay. We are going to study this image compression in detail, okay, in our 7th chapter of Lee and Drew, or our 4th chapter according to our syllabus. Okay. That is JPEG image compression or JPEG 2000 standards and so on. Just for understanding purpose, I'm taking here in this lecture, what are the different applications of image processing. Okay. So first one is image compression. Okay. So there are 2 types of image compression. One is lossless image compression and another one is lossy image compression. Okay. So Lossless means you are not going to lose any kind of information. Okay, even after compression, okay, you are not going to lose any kind of information. Okay, but here in this case, the compression ratio will be less. Okay, compression ratio in lossless compression will be less, and in lossy, in case of lossy, compression ratio will be higher, but at the same time you are going to lose some information, but that is not detectable by our human eyes. Okay, our human vision system cannot detect the lost information. So that advantage is taken in case of lossy compression. Okay, but okay, one more advantage of this lossy compression is that compression ratio is higher in that case. Okay, so this area of research of image processing was a bit saturated, okay, since last 5-10 years, because already the standards are developed. For example, JPEG standard is there for still image compression. Okay, MPEG standard is there for video image compression. Also, H.261, 262, and 263 are the another standards of video compression. Okay, and then achieving the more compression ratio was a bit difficult. Okay, even researchers were trying to develop new algorithm which will give better compression ratio as compared to the previous one, but advancement was not that much. Okay, and now, okay, people have, researchers have started to do the research. Okay, that is hybrid approach in compression. Okay, hybrid approach means basically, see, so for example, in our image, one of the particular area is of very important. Okay, region of importance is there. You don't want to lose the information from that region. Okay, now in that case, the earlier approach was use lossy compression, not lossy, it is lossless compression, so that you are not going to lose any information. But okay, if you use lossless compression, compression ratio will be less. Lossless compression, compression ratio will be less, but our requirement is that, okay, we want more compression ratio as well as would like to preserve information. So the hybrid approach which is used is here in the image. Basically, if this region is of importance, okay, so this is region of importance, ROI, region of importance. So what people have started research that in this region, okay, in this region, okay, apply lossless compression, okay, and the rest of the region is not important in that particular application. So if it is not important, we can use lossy compression. So overall compression of the image, if you use the entire lossless compression, compression ratio will be less, but you are mixing lossy as well as lossless. So overall compression will be, compression ratio will increase. At the same time, we are not going to lose any kind of information. Okay, so this hybrid approach has been started. And the different techniques which are there for lossless image compressions are by using run length encoding, Huffman coding, predictive coding, or lossy image compression, transform based coding, bit plane coding, vector quantization, block truncation, and lossy predictive coding. Okay, so we are going to study the entire thing in our fourth chapter, okay, of our syllabus. Now, already you have, okay, in the previous class, means basically when you are studying image processing, you have studied that one in bit, a little bit. You have studied a little bit. Okay, so what is the block diagram of overall compression technique? I'm talking about the lossy compression technique. How compression is achieved? First thing is that this is your input image. After that, what do you do? Take the transform. Okay, after that, quantization. Then after that, encoding. Okay, so that is the overall block diagram of lossy compression technique. Okay. Now, what is the role? See, this is input image. You'd like to compress this image. Okay. So, what is the role of this transform there? What transform does? Where compression is achieved? Is it in the transform, this one, stage, taking a transform stage, or it is at the quantization, or it is at the encoding? So, basically, you are saying that compression is achieved at third stage, that is compression. It's not correct. Basically, see that when you take the, suppose in JPEG 2000, JPEG standard, the transform which is used is DCT. Okay. What is the role of DCT here? Basically, to decorrelate the image data and represent in a frequency domain. Okay. After representation, see that, suppose for example, if your image is of 256 by 256, if you take the transform of this one, how many coefficients you'll get? Again, 256 by 256. But out of that, okay, low frequency components are important, whereas high frequency components are not that much important. So what we do in compression, lossy compression, okay, these low frequency components which are concentrated at the top left corner of that transform are taken, whereas the rest of the part, okay, is discarded. Okay. So earlier, how many pixels without compression, how many pixels you would have to transmit? 256 into 256. Now, after transform, okay, how many coefficients you got? See, now pixel, after taking the transform, pixel has become a coefficient. Okay, it is not as it is. There is a relation. Okay. So, you are representing that as a transform coefficient. Okay. Now, in this transform coefficient, not all the coefficients are important. Few coefficients are important. So, instead of sending all those 256 by 256 coefficient, okay, what you do? You send few coefficients which are important, okay, and discard rest of the coefficient. So, for example, if you have sent 25% which coefficient which are more important and remaining 75% coefficients which are not much important. Okay. So, those 25% coefficient, what you are going to do? Quantize it, okay, and then after that, encode it. Okay. Now, where compression is achieved? In the transform domain, okay, as well as, okay, what is there in the quantization? Okay, now we are talking about the lossy image compression, where loss is occurring. After taking the transform, loss is occurring. Is it a lossy operation? Means taking transform is a lossy operation or lossless operation? Because see that, see, just you are mapping these pixels into coefficient. Okay. So you are not going to lose any kind of information. If you take the inverse transform of that one, you are going to get the original image back. So transform is not a lossy operation. Which operation is lossy then? If you take the quantization, okay, you are going to do quantization of that signal or pixels or coefficient basically. So certain things you are going to lose. So, here quantization step is basically a lossy operation. What about the encoding last step? Now, encoding, okay, is it a lossy operation or lossless operation? Lossless. Basically, there you are not going to lose. Only thing is that you are coding in different way. Okay. But with that coding also, you can achieve further compression. See that in case of run length encoding, okay, if your image is having like intensities like as a 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 10 times, okay, in run length encoding, what do? We write that 0 is occurring at 10 times. So instead of sending 10 zeros, what we send? We send 0 at the right and then 10. So instead of sending this 10, you are sending only 3 characters. Okay, so there you are going to achieve the compression, but that is lossless compression. So in lossy compression technique, basically compression is achieved by using the transform as well as by using encoding. Okay, and this third stage, that is quantization is a lossy operation. Okay, so with this technique, you can achieve maximum compression ratio. With lossless image compression, you achieve less compression ratio. Okay, so we'll see all those things in detail when we study our fourth chapter. Okay, now see, for this exam, for example, this is the image. Okay, so color image of 600 by 800 pixels. Without compression, how much memory will be needed to store this image? It will be 600 by 800. Okay, since it is a color image, so each pixel will be represented by 24 bits. So it will be 1.44 megabytes. That much memory will be needed to store this image. But if you use the compression, JPEG compression, okay, it needs only 89 kilobytes of memory to store the image. Okay, so definitely compression ratio will be 16:1. Okay, in the same thing is there for movie. Okay, only thing is that in video, what is the change? Okay, there are different frames, and number of frames in that video are 30 frames per second. Okay, and each frame in a video is nothing but still image. Now, each frame in the video is nothing but still image. Okay, for example, here 720 by 480 is the frame size, means that is the individual image size. And how many frames are there? 30 frames per second. Okay, and each pixel in that frame is represented by 24 bits. So I think you can easily calculate how much memory will be needed to store a video of 1 second. So how much it will be? Basically, it will be the size of image, that is 720 multiplied by 480. Okay, multiply by how many bits? 24 bits. Okay, multiply by how many frames are there in the second? That is 36. So that much memory will be needed to store the 1 second video. Okay, now see that this raw video, if you store it, okay, it will be requiring 243 megabits per second. Okay, but if you use the compression in that, so it will require only 5 megabits per second. So you are going to achieve near about 48 times compression as compared to the original. So definitely the memory required for storing the compressed image will be less as compared to the raw image or raw video. Okay. Now another application of image processing is that the denoising. Okay. Now denoising means basically your, see that left side image is corrupted image. Okay, it is corrupted with noise. And you know that in our last lecture, I told you that noise is nothing but high frequency information. So all those high frequencies are occurring here. So a lot of noise is there. Okay, so you'd like to make this image, okay, a good image. You'd like to improve the quality of this image in better way. So definitely, if what you would like to remove? High frequency content. So when you'd like to remove the high frequency content, you have to use the filter, na? So this filter should be low pass filter. Okay, but if you use the low pass filter directly, okay, this special filter, low pass filter, the disadvantage of this special domain low pass filter is that, okay, it will remove the noise, but at the same time it will blur the edges, because this low pass filtering operation is nothing but the averaging. See that if you look at 3x3 template of this low pass filter, it consists of the coefficients like as 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 1 multiplied by 1 by 9. Means when you keep this template on the pixel which is of interest, so center of this template is kept on the pixel of the interest, and then neighboring pixels are multiplied by 1, and then summation of that, all these intensity values of those neighboring pixel is taken, and then average value, that is divided by 9. Okay, so this, the pixel of where you are doing the filtering, okay, will be replaced with what? Will be replaced with the average value of total 8 coefficient including the self one. Okay, so total 9 coefficient or total 9 pixels surrounding that one. When there is basically age, okay, what happens? Suppose for example, if your pixel of interest is the age pixel, and you are going to, when you are doing the filtering at that time, what you are going to do? You are going to consider the pixel which is of left side, which is of right side, which is at top side, which is at bottom side, which is at top left corner, top right corner, okay, bottom right corner, bottom left corner. Okay. Now see that here the center pixel is of edge pixel, but the left one, right one, or neighboring pixels are not edge pixel. Or suppose for example, if there is a, okay, just above that one, it is edge pixel, below that one, it is also edge pixel. That edge is vertical basically. Okay. Rest of the pixels are not edge. So for example, rest of the pixels are having value equal to 255, 255, and only this vertical is having value equal to 0. Okay. Now, when you are filtering this image, what happens basically? This value is 0, but filtered image corresponding pixel will be equal to what? Okay. Now, how many pixels are there having 255 value here in that template? 6. So, 255 into 6 plus how many pixels are having 0 value? 3. So, that is 0 into 3. So, 255 into 6 plus 0 into 3 divided by how many pixels we are considering? 9. So, it will be what? So, definitely it will be greater than 0. See, earlier what was that value? It was 0, but now after filtering it is becoming greater than 0, and it is like as the surrounding pixels. So definitely here the edge was formed because of 0 intensity, but now after filtering basically the intensity at that location has been increased or changed. So if you use this simple averaging filter, it blurs the edges. So to take care of that one, another filtering technique is used, that is nothing but the median filtering. Okay. Now, median filtering, how median filtering is done? So, for example, here, okay, the pixel of interest, okay, or for example, there is a noise pixel, noisy pixel is there, okay, this is having intensity equal to 0, noisy pixel having intensity equal to 0, and rest of the pixels are equal to 255. Noisy pixel, rest of the pixels, surrounding pixels are equal to 255, okay. Now, when you represent this image, okay, forget about this one. When you represent this image, what kind of image you'll get? Okay, when you display this image on a computer, see that there is one dot at the center, rest of the part, okay, it is white. So, white image and at the center there is a dot. So that dot we are, okay, we consider that it as a, okay, basically noise. Now with median filtering, what we do? Basically in that 3 by 3, okay, the, if you consider the mask of size 3 by 3, okay, we consider all the pixels in this 3 by 3 mask, okay, and we arrange all the intensities, okay, of all those 3 by 3 masks in ascending order. So what will be the value of first pixel, or when you are writing this one in ascending order? 0. Then only one pixel is having 0 value, rest of the 8 pixels are having equal to 255. Okay. Now what is the median value? That is the fifth value, that is equal to 255. So your filtered image corresponding pixel will be replaced with the median value. So what will be the filtered image pixel value? 255. What was earlier? It was 0. Now see that the surrounding pixels are already 255. The filtered image pixel will be also again 255. So you'll get the, you can remove the noise. Okay. So here basically median filter is used because it preserves the edges as well as it removes the noise smoothly. Okay. So filtering techniques are generally used for removing the noise, and that is that too. Low pass filtering and median filtering. Okay, this deblurring. Okay, deblurring. Why deblurring occurs? Another application of image processing is deep learning. Why deep learning occurs? Or why blurring occurs basically? Blurring of the image. As I gave one example, okay, in my very first lecture, that when you are moving in a car and if you take the picture, okay, so you get the blurred image because your, okay, sometime camera may shake, okay, and you get the blurred picture. Now, with the blurred picture, some portion of that image is not visible properly. Okay, so to make it good picture, okay, you have to use deep blurring algorithm or restoration algorithm. So, by using restoration algorithm, you can remove the blurring. See that this is the restored image whose quality is better as compared to the original blurred image. Okay. Now, another example of image processing is that simple addition of the images. See that in image processing or computer vision or the related area, generally simple operations or simple operation gives better result, okay, rather than the complex one. Okay, so try to find out the simple solutions, okay, while doing the image processing project. Okay. Now here, see that this is your A image and this is another B image. Okay, if you add A image and B image, you'll get this image. Simple addition of the image. So this image and this image is added together, you got the, okay, addition of the two image. Okay, now another example is here, okay, that is averaging the images of the same scene, okay, for removing the noise. Okay, see that if you do the, if you take the average of same image several times, the noisy image will become the good image. See that earlier this image was there. Okay, so if you take the averaging of the same image several times, you are going to remove the noise. Okay, so again it is nothing but the low pass filtering. Averaging is nothing but low pass filtering. So this is another example of simple operation. Okay, now see here what it changed in this image. There are two images, A image and B image. What is changed in the B image? This bottle is not there. See that this bottle is present over here and this is not there. Okay. Now, if you subtract this image from this image, what do you expect? Only bottle will be the output, because the pixel intensity at this location is same as this one. Pixel intensity at any other location is same, except pixel location, pixel intensity, okay, in this region is different than this one. So wherever is there is a difference, okay, you can, okay, if you take the difference between two image, you can observe that difference. See that just by simple subtraction of two images, you can find the bottle, absolute difference. So, what do you think? Where we can use this one, this application? This simple operation is having a fantastic application. Motion detection. Yes, motion detection difference is used. Any other? Okay, see, simple angiography. In angiography, okay, simple image difference is taken. See that. So, for example, if that person is suffering with a some blockage, okay, if that person is suffering with some blockage, okay, how it is detected in angiography? Basically, initially the X-ray of that person is taken, okay. So, definitely that X-ray will be of that vein as well as of that block. So, you got one X-ray image, okay. Now, okay, after that, these doctor people, what they do? They inject the basically contrast agent through that vein. Okay, now this contrast agent, when it is injected through that vein, it will be available in the entire van except the blockage area. Okay, because see that portion is blocked, so it will not your contrast agent will not be present in that. Rest of the part there will be agent. Now wear intensity is changed if you consider the particularly when wear intensity is changed at the blockage or at the rest of the part. Blockage will remain same na in earlier and after injection also. Now it is assumed that that patient is not moved. Okay, immediately another X-ray is taken. Okay, so you have first X-ray and you have second X-ray. Okay, now what is changed here? Basically the rest of the part of the vein is changed. What is constant? Blockage part is constant. So where you will get the, if you take the difference between the first X-ray and second X-ray, where you will get the zero intensity? At the blockage level, because the intensity at that location in the first X-ray and in the second X-ray will be same. So difference will be zero. Okay, and if difference is zero, it will be represented as a black spot. So you can easily detect where is the blockage. So simple difference technique is useful for this angiography. Okay, another application, I'll tell you, fantastic application. In 2006 I had been to ICSIP at Hubli. There was one conference, Italy conference. Okay, and one of the company, okay, they were showcasing their product from Bangalore. They came there in the conference and they were showcasing that product. Okay, they developed a smart camera. Okay, they developed the smart camera to monitor the basically, or to do the traffic control. Now in traffic control we know that we use the open loop system, na? So based on the time, okay, that signals will operate based on the time. Okay, but they would like to develop the system, okay, the signals will operate based on the traffic flow. Okay, and for that they developed the smart camera. Okay, name was fantastic. Okay, and the price of that was also very high. They were selling that with high price. Okay, but the technology which was used was very, very simple technology. Okay, what they were doing, just they were capturing the pictures and then they were taking the difference between the two picture. Okay, if difference is zero, so earlier traffic and the okay, it will be same. If difference is large, means there is something change. Okay, so based on that one they were taking the decision. So basically technology which was used was very, very simple technology, but how many people doesn't know, no? So they will pay high for that one because it is a smart camera. Okay, so here see that how this angiography is done. See that digital subtraction angiography, medical imaging technique used to see the blood vessels. Okay, in that take one X-ray, inject the contrast agent, then take another X-ray that and hope the patient hasn't moved or even he breathed too much. Okay, after that subtract the first, that is background, from the second, that is background plus vessel, and you can easily detect where is the blockage. So simple application of image processing, that is image subtraction, is useful in angiography. Okay, now another concept of image processing is histogram. What is histogram? What is histogram? What is image histogram? Okay, it is the plot of number of occurrence of certain pixel values. Okay, in a grayscale image, okay, how many intensity levels are there? 0 to 255. It's not 0 to 256. Okay, otherwise you 1 to 256. In total there are 256 gray levels. If you are considering 0, it will be maximum will be 255. So 256 gray levels are there. So in histogram what we do, we calculate how many pixels in the entire image are having zero value. So plot that one. Then how many pixels are having one value, so like that way in 1 to 10 up to 255. So this graph, that is pixel value and number of occurrences of that pixel value, this plot is called as image histogram. Okay, this plot is called as image histogram. Now this image histogram is really useful in many applications of image processing. Okay, for example, we'll see that. Now, here I have shown you four histograms. Okay, one is, see that top image. This image is captured in a dark room. Most of the pixels of this are having intensities towards zero, or towards left side of this pixel intensity. Okay. So your overall histogram will be having intensities or located like this of dark image. Okay. Now, whether this dark image, the object is visible in this dark image? No, the quality of that image is not good. Now, take extreme case, another case, where a lot of light is there. Okay. And then if you capture the picture, okay, what will happen? Most of the pixels will be having higher value of intensity. So if you plot the histogram of that one, this histogram will be skewed towards the higher value side. Okay, it will be towards higher value side. So this one, like this, bright image. So earlier was dark image. Next one, second one is bright image. Neither dark image looks better nor bright image looks better. Okay. Now see that this is the image. Okay. Neither it is dark or bright, but this is the low contrast image. Most of the pixel intensities are located at the center. Okay. There is no dynamic range, or dynamic range of that pixel is very less. So that image also doesn't look good. What is by contrast? See, low contrast means what? Contrast of the image means what exactly? Okay, basically the contrast, and technically it is defined as, it is having low dynamic range. The difference between the lower value of pixel intensity and the higher value of pixel intensity is less. Generally, while choosing our dress, we choose the contrast dress, no? Black and white. If you take in the entire thing black, okay, your physical appearance will not be good, no? Okay, because there is no contrast. Black pant, black shirt, black everything. Okay. So to look better, you should have the contrast combination. Okay. Or even if you take, for example, there are two teachers. Consider the case that both the teachers are good. Can you see the difference between these two people? You cannot observe. But another case, if one teacher is not teaching that way good, another teacher is teaching very nicely, you can easily detect the difference between these two teachers. So, because there is a lot of contrast between teacher A and teacher B. So, basically, to get it recognized, okay, there should be large contrast. Okay. So, if your image is of low contrast, okay, most of the objects are not visible. So, what is done basically, the dynamic range of this image, pixel intensity is increased by stretching this histogram. See, that suppose, for example, this is the high contrast image where the pixel intensities are ranging from low to high. So definitely this image looks better as compared to this one. Okay. So generally image histogram technique, okay, this histogram stretching technique is used to make the good image. Now, this histogram technique is applicable in many applications. For example, image enhancement. It is also used in image segmentation and image compression. Now, in image enhancement, basically where it is used? Okay, where we use the image enhancement technique? Basically, if your image quality is poor. Image quality is poor means it is totally dark image. So, if you visualize that image, most of the objects are not visible. Okay. So, if you enhance the pixel intensity of that one, so all those objects which are there in the image will be visible. Okay. So, you will get the better quality image. So, image enhancement technique is used to make the bad quality image into good quality image. Okay. So, how this histogram technique is useful for this one, we will see the example here. See that. This is the application of this image. Okay. So, this baby girl, her photo was taken in the dark room. If you see the original photograph, okay, it looks, it doesn't look good enough. And if you plot the histogram of that one, most of the pixel intensities are lying below 120. Okay, most of the pixel intensities are lying below 120. Now, in enhancement technique by using histogram, what is done basically? This histogram is stretched towards right side. So, see that the dynamic range of this pixel intensity, okay, earlier it was from 10 to 110 or 120 here, okay, but now after stretching this one histogram, the dynamic range of this has increased from 0 to 255. And then correspondingly, if you represent that image or if you display the image, okay, corresponding pixels, the quality of this image will be better as compared to the original one. Okay. So, simple histogram stretching technique is used to make the bad quality image into good quality image by, okay, that is image enhancement by using histogram stretching. Okay. Now, another application of histogram based image segmentation. See that. Okay. So, there is one foreground object as well as there is background object. Okay. Foreground as well as background object. Now, if you see that this background consists of, what is the intensity of this background pixels? Zero, almost zero. Definitely there will be different intensity of this foreground. So, if you plot the histogram of that one, okay, definitely you will get the two bars, okay, one will be representing the background, another one will be representing foreground, okay, and it will, in between these two bars, if you set a threshold like as the center one, so all the pixels below that intensity, if you assign 0 and all the pixels above that threshold value, if you assign 1, what will happen basically? The background will be 0 and your foreground will be totally white. So, you can clearly segment the foreground from the background. So, by using simple technique of histogram thresholding, you can segment the image. Okay. Then, another example of this enhancement, that is contrast stretching. See that there are various kind of stretching. One is linear stretching, non-linear stretching and so on. Okay. This is another example. This is the picture which I took when I was at IIT Kharagpur. This is the computer vision lab of IIT Kharagpur. Okay. So, this is the dark image. Okay. After, see, nothing is visible in this image. But if you do the image enhancement by contrast stretching, the things will be more visible. Okay. So, this is example of contrast stretching. Okay. Now, this is mid-level image processing basically. Example of mid-level image processing. You are trying to identify the edges and all those things. Okay, see that this is another example of mid-level image processing segmentation. Okay, our third example of mid-level image processing is see that you'd like to extract the feature of the image. Okay, how to extract the feature of the image? Okay, why features are extracted? In pattern recognition, we use the image features. Okay. Without extracting the feature, is it not possible to detect the object? It is possible or not? So, for example, okay, this is, if I take the image of this one, okay, and if I keep that image in my database, okay, I have developed a simple template matching system in pattern recognition. Okay. Whenever I get another this kind of image, what I'm going to do? I'm going to just match with this one. In what way? Simple subtraction. Okay. So if that image is same, what will happen? Subtraction will be zero. So I can say that that image is similar to that class. So then I can classify that, yes, this image belongs to class 1, this image belongs to class 2, and so on. But how many subtractions you have to do? If your image size is 256 by 256 in the database, okay. If it is 256 by 256, and then suppose, for example, there are, suppose, 1,000 images in your database. Okay, 1,000 images are there in the database. And whenever your query pattern comes, what you are going to do? Query pattern, you are going to this query image, you are going to match with the database image. In simple way, subtraction. If that query image and database image is same, the subtraction will be zero. I can say that, yes, this belongs to that class. But how many subtractions you have to do? If it is 256 by 256, so 256 into 256, total subtractions you have to do. For, okay, how many times? You are not going to compare only with one. You have to compare the entire image database. So how much time it will take? Basically, it will take a lot of time. Second thing is that, for example, now your image, database image and the query image is same. Database image and query image is same. Only thing is that your query pattern is shifted to the right by 1 pixel. Just circular shift. What happens? Your first column becomes second column becomes third column, and the last column becomes first column. Now, when you visualize this database image and the query image, can you detect the change in that visually? It's not possible. Okay. Visually, you'll see that both the images are same, but now when you take the difference, instead of like this, it will be like this. Means you are going to take the difference between, instead of first, it will be first and second, okay, and then second and third, and so on. Do you think that you'll get the difference equal to zero? No. So though images are same, you'll not get the difference equal to zero. And then what you are going to conclude with that one? This query image is not like as the database image. Okay. So even if image is same, okay, you are going to misclassify it. Second thing is that it may happen that your database image is of 256 by 256, but your query pattern, which looks like as a database image, but the size is, suppose for example, 128 by 128. See that. This image is of 128 by 128, only, okay, with another resolution you have taken that one. And here, okay, half resolution you have taken, and this is with 256 by 256. Appearance will be same. Only thing is that quality may be different. What will happen? Can you compare pixel to pixel here? Because number of pixels here in this image are 256 into 256, whereas in the second case, it is 120 into 120. You cannot directly compare one to one. Okay. So these are the limitations of template-based matching in pattern recognition. So what is next level of abstraction? Instead of comparing the images based on pixel values, okay, the feature of that images are extracted. So for example, we have extracted the feature, 8 features of the image. 8 feature means, how do you extract the feature basically? Feature should be distinguishable. Means suppose for example, if you take the example of Amitabh Bachchan and Amir Khan. These are the 2 persons, okay. Now, these 2 persons would like to develop the system which will recognize who is Amit, who is Amir. Okay. So, what kind of features you will extract from these two? One is height, because the height of Amitabh is higher than Amit. Okay. Then second one is voice is different. Third one is, how do you measure the age? Years, you are talking about age, no? Years, okay. I don't know, I am not, okay, years are different, okay. So there are several distinguishable features okay, you can extract those features, and then if you compare, so definitely the difference between these two people will be large, difference between the self will be less. So these features are extracted, okay. So this is nothing but the mid-level operation. Now here I have taken a simple example that, so for example here, it is a circular object and this is a square object or rectangular object. Now, if we take feature as a radius, okay, feature as a radius, now we are calculating, we are finding the radius of that object for each theta. Okay, now, so for example, here, theta is equal to 0, what is the radius of this one? This will be A, na? So I have plotted this one at theta equal to 0, radius is A. Now theta is increased, radius will be A always. So this R will be always A in case of circular object. So whatever may be the theta, whether it is 0, pi by 4, pi by 2 or 2 pi, its radius value will be always constant, that is equal to A. So what we got? Feature as a straight line. Okay. What about same feature if you extract of this square object? Okay. Now it was A. As theta goes on increasing, your radius of that will increase. That will be peak at this location. Again, it will start decreasing. Again, it will be peak some. So you'll get the signature. This is also called as the descriptor. This is also called as the signature of that object. So your feature, okay, will of this circular, this rectangular object will be like this. Now, if you take the third object like as a triangular object, okay, and if you extract the feature like as the R and theta, what kind of feature you'll get? What will be the signature of that one? It will be again another triangle kind of thing, okay. So, when we can say that, when we get the R as constant, what we can conclude? That object is a circular. If we get the feature like this, then we can conclude that object is square. If we get the triangular kind of thing, we conclude that object is triangular. Okay. So, basically, here features are extracted to classify the object in case of pattern recognition. So this is nothing but the mid-level operation in case of image processing. Okay, I think we'll stop here, and the remaining part of our lecture will continue tomorrow. So thank you very much.